operating your weapon system in extreme cold weather can prove to be pretty problematic, especially if you're not well versed in those conditions. There are a lot of tricks and tips that can save your butt out there and can really help you to operate your weapon a lot more effectively. Now, I have had the opportunity throughout 30 years of shooting to try various different platforms in extreme cold weather conditions, whether it be deer hunting, running and gunning, shooting steel, doing long-range target shooting, or trying to keep your service rifle fed. There are a lot of things that you need to consider that change significantly in extreme cold weather conditions, some of them you might not have thought of. In this video, we're going to get zoomed in on some of the things that will help you to run a precision bolt action more effectively. Although a lot of semi-automatic platforms can be made to operate okay under those conditions, unless you keep your weapon perfectly maintained and dry, most semi-auto platforms may prove to be pretty problematic, especially when you get below negative 20 degrees Fahrenheit. So in this video, we're going to focus on the use of bolt-action rifles with optics in extreme cold weather conditions. And although bolt actions are not near as fussy as a lot of semi-automatics when you're talking about very, very cold conditions where you might not be perfectly dry, there are still certain things you need to be aware of. So here are some tips we gave on one of our shoots out in the field before the cameras froze up.
Howdy, Rex here. Today we're going to do some extreme cold weather training tips on long-range precision rifles, or any other rifle for that matter. Some things that'll help you not freeze your rifle up in the field when you got blowing snow and extremely cold temperatures. There are some things that will really save your bacon, if you want to put it that way. So what we're going to do is, first thing you're going to notice, they have this rifle in the vehicle, and I'm going to deploy it in cold weather. The problem is this rifle is at ambient air temperature for the inside of the vehicle, which is kind of warm, right? The second I pull this thing out, what's going to happen is it's going to get stuck with a lot of snow, and that snow is going to melt until this thing cools off to ambient outside air temperature. So one thing you can do is you can take your rifle in the case outside of the vehicle and let it cool down to ambient air temperature. It might take a little bit of time, but it'll really help you out. Okay, so as you can see, we let her cool down to ambient air temp, and she's pretty darn cold at the moment, but the snow shouldn't stick to it so bad. One thing you might want to do if you got a fancy optic is you can cover it up with a grocery bag just for when you're doing your walking and stuff, the critical components. So you can keep your rifle wrapped with the grocery bag, your turrets and such, and you can throw a rubber band around here, tie a string on it, or just kind of hold it like this as you're walking. That's going to keep you out of a lot of trouble until you're ready to deploy this thing. Especially if you're laying in a static position waiting for targets to present themselves, you don't want this thing to get iced up. Your optic is already going to have a hard enough time with the cold temperature, so you want to take that into consideration. Another thing you should do is get your settings adjusted for what you anticipate you're going to need beforehand, because the grease in these scopes, especially if you got variable zoom, parallax adjustments, will freeze, okay? So I'm gonna put this on 10 power. That's a good universal magnification power for this kind of application. And I'm gonna turn my parallax to about, we'll say 300. Under today's conditions with extreme wind and the limited visibility, I'm probably not gonna shoot much beyond 300. If something is closer than 300, I'm gonna be totally hosed if I set this at 600, right? So I can still take a shot. It's not gonna be ideal. But I do want to just, you might be able to still adjust your parallax anyways. However, I am going to set it in kind of a median position, right in the middle of the bell curve of where I expect to be shooting, okay? So one thing, and it's probably the most important tip of them all, is you're going to want to secure any kind of ports or the muzzle on your rifle with electrical tape, okay? Now, the reason for this is, maybe you haven't thought of this before, but if you're in the snow and you're walking around with a rifle, if this tip of this barrel at any point touches anything with snow on it, and you get snow in there, and it might melt, you might not see it. One drop of water inside the barrel at the tip of there can cause catastrophic failure, okay? You'll blow the end of your barrel off, and you might injure or kill yourself doing that. So I'm gonna secure these ports. And you don't need to do it real tight, but just so that we don't get blowing snow filling up this muzzle inadvertently with the precipitation today. That ought to do it right there, okay? So we have some tape on the ports, And I'm just going to put a little bit over the end like so. I'm not going to tape it on super tight. I'm just going to have it like this. A little bit loose. And that might look stupid, but that's going to save me from blowing this thing up. You don't want any kind of snow or rain or anything getting in there. Especially where you're walking with the rifle. If that muzzle of the rifle touches snow at any point, you're going to get a tiny bit in there. That's where most of your guys lose their front gun sights in the snowy weather when they shoot, or it bulges on the end and they can't figure out why the end of their barrel became deformed, or their sight blew off, or the whole rifle banana peeled all the way back to the action. They got a little bit of snow on the tip of the barrel. So this might not look very tactical or very cool, but it's gonna save you a lot of trouble. There's less noisy stuff than this, but in a blizzard where the wind's blowing like this, it's not gonna give away your position due to sound, in all honesty. And whatever you can do to keep this dry, they'd probably make some neoprene scope bras or whatever you call them that you can put on your optics that keep them more clean, that you can quickly detach. On the muzzle, you can see we have some tape here that we just put on, and what you want to be aware of, and you might want need to put a rubber band around there because it's going to freeze. It's already frozen solid, this tape, so it's not adhering very well. You don't want it too super tight, but when you shoot, all the volume of air in front of your bullet, okay, is going to supersonically blast this tape off, this muzzle, on your first shot before the bullet exits the muzzle. And so all this tape is gonna be gone before the bullet reaches it, so it's not gonna be a problem. It's gonna be a lot less of a problem than water or snow in your barrel, okay? So this is not actually gonna significantly affect your point of impact, even on the first shot, but it will save your butt if you're out all day in a blizzard getting snow in your bore.
You're nailing it while it's swinging.
So as we discussed here, it's very important to make sure that when you're deploying the weapon, you can allow it to reach its ambient air temperature in a controlled environment that's not going to be very wet. Otherwise, you're going to have problems. You allow it to cool down in a dry spot before you expose it to any kind of precipitation or blowing snow. And that's to prevent that snow from melting and then icing up your rifle and your optic. Another important factor to consider here is that if you're going to be operating at outside ambient temperatures and inside vehicles, or taking the rifle in and out of buildings or houses where it could be potentially a lot more warm, exposing the rifle to quick shifts in temperature, you need to be aware that you're going to have condensation occur on this rifle when you bring it indoors or back into the car. If possible, if you plan on redeploying that rifle again later, what's going to happen is that your rifle is going to be so cold, kind of like a glass that's been stored in the freezer. When you bring it into standard air temperature, it's going to condense water all over it. So the thing's going to become soaked all over. It's going to be on the inside and on the outside. The entire weapon could get just completely drenched, in which case you're going to have to go through it to make sure that your firing pin hole especially is not obstructed. Make sure that your optics are dried so that you can see through them if you're going to be redeploying that weapon again anytime soon before you have time to dry it off. Also, you need to pay attention to your bore. Condensation will occur on the inside of the barrel as well, and that could be a big problem, not only for corrosion, but if you do have to run back outside or get back outside the car again, it's going to ice up. You are now going to be taking an extremely cold and wet rifle back out into those conditions, and you're going to have a complete icing up of the rifle, not to mention bore obstructions potentially, and that's going to be a huge thing, so you're going to want to be very careful. If you can, it's probably wise, if you don't need to use the rifle indoors or inside the vehicle, is to either leave the weapon in a place that's rather cool or allow it to warm up more slowly so that the condensation is not as radical. So if you have a garage or something that's not quite as warm as the indoors, you can keep the rifle in the case so that the warm-up of that weapon is retarded and that it doesn't happen too quickly, and then it should mitigate some of your problems with condensation. If you bring the rifle straight into the automobile or straight into the house or building from the outside, it's going to condense very quickly. Also, any snow or ice that may have accumulated in nooks and crannies on the rifle are going to melt, obviously, and then you will have to do a full bore cleaning of that weapon if you plan on putting it back on the rack or if you plan on redeploying it out in the cold weather. to ensure reliability and to make sure you don't get it corroded up. When you're talking about maintenance of your weapons in extreme cold weather, when we're talking about bolt-action rifles, they're not near as fussy as some other platforms because you operate it manually, and a lot of that can be overcome just by how much force you give it when you work the action. But you do need to be aware of a couple things primarily, and like we said before with the optic, once it cools down, you want to be very careful not to get too western on your magnification setting because a lot of times that gets very cold. They do make levers that increase your leverage on those optics and makes them easier to turn in the cold weather. However, that can possibly be a problem, and you don't want to apply too much force more than the thing is engineered for. And a lot of times, even without the assistance of such devices that make your magnification ring easier to turn, you can actually break something in the optics. Stuff can come undone, can come unglued. You can strip stuff out. I've done it on my old Schmitt and Bender and a few other variables in my years, and I kind of learned over time that even on a really well-made optic, you just want to kind of set it, and if it gets really cold, if your magnification setting can't be adjusted with relative ease just using your fingers, then you probably don't want to just force it or gain a leverage advantage over it because it might not be engineered to take that, and things will probably break, especially when it gets really cold. In terms of the rifle itself, a couple key points to consider is that you can, on a bolt-action rifle, you always want to make sure that your bolt lugs have a little bit of lubrication on them. You don't want to get too crazy with your lube in extreme cold weather because that stuff really, really gums things up when it gets really cold. One place that you do want to make sure is absolutely dry is the firing pin hole. And we're talking from both oil and moisture. That's not a good place to put oil when it's very, very cold because that will retard the firing pin. And you might have a primer strike, but it might be too light to go off. That goes with a lot of different weapons. Bolt actions are certainly that way. Some of your more rugged battle rifle designs aren't as fussy in terms of the firing pin. Your striker fire pistols are definitely that way. Most of your pump shotguns are going to be that way. So when you're looking at your firing pin hole, you're going to want to make sure that that's basically clean and dry. And then take special note, too, that when you're in the field, if you've got blowing snow or a lot of precipitation and it's very cold to where that thing could potentially freeze up, you want to take a lot of care into making sure you don't get water on your bolt face. One thing you can do is to get a round chambered and safety engaged before you expose the rifle to precipitation. That's just to keep the water out of there. You're going to at least have one good shot, and if you have to lay down a string of fire, you should be able to get that off before it freezes up if you do get precipitation in there once you open up the bolt. Now, for long-term operations, if you do work the bolt and there's blowing snow that got in there, you're going to want to remove the bolt and ensure that there is no icing in there, ensure that the firing pin is able to move forward. Likewise, your trigger mechanism should be kept dry. That standard maintenance on most platforms is to keep them dry. But just make darn sure that you don't get any oil in your trigger. You don't want any moisture getting in there if you can help it. Those are the two parts that are really going to cause failure out there, especially in the bolt action. Now, in a semi-automatic platform, there's a lot of variance between the different designs. Some designs are a lot more inherently reliable than others. Some of the weapons with your very loose tolerances that are designed to be quite rugged, like your Kalashnikov family, for example, they're going to be very impervious to cold weather. They're going to run in most conditions quite well. You can completely bury them in snow, and it's not going to cause them to fail, especially once you warm it up at that first round. It knocks all the ice and snow out of there, and the weapon will operate fine. AR-15s, AR-10s, that whole gas impingement stoner platform, that's going to be a bit more fussy in cold weather. And your maintenance schedule is going to have to be a little bit different if you're planning on employing it in those kind of weather conditions. A lot of your Alpine Special Warfare units, like your 10th Mountain Division, these guys, they sometimes run a synthetic lubricant or a lithium grease. And some of them even use some other dry lubricants that supposedly work a little better in cold weather. But a lot of folks, when you're operating in extreme Arctic conditions, especially with that rifle, it's almost best to keep it as dry as possible. There are certain points that do need to be lubed a little bit, so I normally run an axle grease consistency lube. However, in extreme cold weather, it might be smart to use a bit thinner of an oil, something more of a traditional gun oil, but you don't want to get too generous with it. You want to apply it very thinly in just the key spots. For example, on your bolt carrier where you actually, there's four different raceways of contact inside there. That's going to be something you're going to want to have a little bit of oil on. But for the most part, you're going to find out in extreme cold weather, especially once the weapon gets a little bit dirty, especially if you're running a suppressor, where you have accelerated fouling, is that when the weapon heats up and there's blowing snow and precipitation, it's going to facilitate an icing up of the weapon. So you're going to want to keep your dust covers closed, and you're just going to want to keep aware and make sure it's broke free after it cools back down. Work the action a couple times, take your mag out. Work the action a couple times, make sure everything's operating again. After the weapon's warmed up and been iced up a little bit due to melting snow that has refrozen. Your bolt inside the bolt carrier can almost be kept dry, if not a very almost microscopic layer of a film of very light oil would be okay. But just be prepared in extreme cold weather environments, especially if you're running an AR-15 style rifle, that you're going to have to maintain that a lot more rigorously. If it does ever get exposed to water or precipitation when it's freezing, you're going to want to make sure that the rifle's still operational periodically, just to ensure that it's going to go when you need it to go. And as you can see here, whenever you finally do bring your weapon back inside after it's cold, condensation is probably going to occur, especially if you have extreme cold weather. That rifle is going to warm up. There's going to be condensation on it. The snow and ice is going to melt in places you didn't realize it was hiding. And you're going to have to do a complete strip down of that weapon, ensure that everything is dried. And then at that point, you can run in a lightly oiled patch through your bore to make sure that you don't have any moisture hiding in your rifling. You might even have to get the trigger mechanism out of there if it's wet, just to ensure that it's not going to corrode on you if the rifle's going to sit inside again for a while. So in the event that you're operating in extreme cold weather environments, when you do bring that weapon inside, if you don't do a good job making sure that your weapon is dry, when you redeploy that a couple hours later after lunch or after that next morning, that sucker is going to be iced up. Going to get iced up in places that you can't see, especially if it's in a firing pin hole or somewhere in the trigger, you're going to have a malfunction. And I've seen that probably dozens and dozens of times. It's not uncommon for a rifle to get froze up like that. So make sure that when you do bring it inside that it gets properly maintained and completely dried off, especially those key components we talked about. So I hope this little tutorial here offers some food for thought when we're talking about extreme cold weather conditions. Very unique conditions for sure. Most folks probably aren't ever going to operate in conditions like this unless you're in the northern Great Plains, Alaska, Canada, Siberia, up in some alpine climates, places like that. You might experience conditions like this. So you don't want it sneaking up on you and nipping you in the butt. Right, guys? Stay tuned for the next review.
So